Welcome to our lesson on infinite geometric series. The goal of the video is to determine if an infinite geometric series converges or diverges. Let's first review what an infinite geometric series is. If the formula to generate the terms in the series is in the form of a times r raised to the power of n, we have a geometric series. So for example here, when n is equal to 0, we'd have a times r to the 0, which would just give us a. When n is equal to 1, we'd have a times r to the first, and then a times r to the second, and so on. So to generate each term in a geometric series, we multiply each consecutive term by another factor of r. To go from the first term to the second term, we multiply by r. To go from the second term to the third term, we multiply by r. And this will be the pattern for any geometric series. The common ratio r can be found from the terms by taking any term in the series and dividing by the term before it. So for example, if we took this third term, ar squared, and divided by the term before it, ar to the first, this simplifies to r. And this would be true for any two consecutive terms. We also said in a previous video that the partial sum of any geometric series is equal to a times the quantity 1 minus r to the n divided by 1 minus r. However, in this video, we want to consider the sum of an infinite geometric series. An infinite geometric series converges if the absolute value of r is less than 1, and it converges to a, the first term, divided by 1 minus r. And if the absolute value of r is greater than or equal to 1, the series diverges. So if we were to take a look at the first few terms in this series, 4 times 1 half to the 0 would be 4, plus 4 times 1 half to the first, that would be 2, plus 4 times 1 half squared, that'd be 1 fourth, that'd be 1, and so on. But looking at this, our common ratio r is equal to 1 half, and the first term is equal to 4. Since the absolute value of r is less than 1, this infinite geometric series does have a sum and therefore converges. And it's equal to the first term 4 divided by 1 minus 1 half. Well, 4 divided by 1 half would be 8. Let's take a look at this graphically to better understand why the absolute value of r must be less than 1. What we're taking a look at now is the graph of the terms of the geometric series we just considered. The first term was 4, our common ratio was 1 half, so 4 times 1 half was equal to 2, 2 times 1 half was equal to 1, and so on. But remember, to determine if a series converges, we must consider the partial sums. So let's go ahead and graph the partial sums in blue. So again, in red we see the terms, and in blue we see the partial sums. Let's watch what happens as we increase the number of terms. You can see very quickly that the partial sums converge to 8, as we see here on the y-axis. Let's go ahead and decrease the number of terms, and what I want you to watch is what happens to the partial sums as n approaches 1 and then becomes greater than 1. Right away, we see that it's taking longer for the partial sums to converge as we approach 1. And then right when we hit 1, and then it becomes greater than 1, you can see that the partial sums are no longer converging. They're increasing without bound and therefore diverging. So here's a nice visual of why the absolute value of r must be less than 1. Notice if we change the initial term to 1 and r to 3 fourths or 0.75, as we increase the number of terms, it's pretty easy to see that this series will converge to 4. Let's go ahead and take a look at this in a more formal way. Remember, this was the formula for the partial sum of a geometric series. If we take the limit of this partial sum as n approaches infinity, it should give us the infinite sum. Notice that a and 1 minus r are not affected by n, so we can factor those out, and we're left with the limit as n approaches infinity of 1 minus r to the power of n. If the absolute value of r is less than 1, then r to the power of n is going to approach 0 as n approaches infinity. Again, if absolute value of r is less than 1, if we raise that to higher and higher powers, it's going to approach 0. So as long as the absolute value of r is less than 1, this will be the limit of 1 minus 0, which is equal to 1. And so we'll have a divided by 1 minus r times 1, which does give us the formula to find the sum of an infinite geometric series. Let's go and take a look at a couple more examples. Sometimes it may not be possible to recognize that a series is geometric right away. So if we're ever not sure, we should just start generating the terms. So when n is equal to 0, we'd have 3 divided by 10 to the first, plus when n is 1, we have 3 divided by 10 to the second, plus when n is 2, we have 3 divided by 10 to the third. And at some point, we do have to recognize that there's a pattern here where we're multiplying the denominator by 10 each time. Well, multiplying the denominator by 10 each time is the same as multiplying by 1/10. So in this case, r is equal to 1/10. 3/10 times 1/10 would be 3/100. 3/100 times 1/10 would be 3/1000, and so on. So since the absolute value of r is less than 1, this will converge, and it will converge to the first term divided by 1 minus r. So we're going to have 3/10 divided by 1 minus 1/10. Well, that's going to be 3/10 divided by 9/10. This is the same as taking 3/10 and multiplying by the reciprocal, so 10/9. This simplifies nicely. So this infinite sum is equal to 1/3. Therefore, this infinite series converges. And we actually looked at this problem in the introductory video. Now on this problem, we probably can recognize this as a geometric series and also identify the value of r. Notice as n increases, we keep multiplying by another factor of 3/2. So r is equal to 3/2. And we can actually stop right here because if the absolute value of r is not less than 1, we know that this will diverge. So this series diverges. Again, it does take some practice to recognize geometric series. So if we weren't sure about this, we'd have to start to generate the terms and then recognize the pattern. Let's go ahead and take a look at one more. Here, we're not given the formula that's used to generate these terms. We have to recognize it ourselves. So notice that all of these are in fractions, so it might be helpful to put this first term as a fraction. Notice the numerators are all 8, and the denominators are powers of 3. This would be 3 to the 0, 3 to the 1st, 3 to the 2nd, and so on. Or we're multiplying the denominator by 3 each time. This would be the same as multiplying by 1/3. So r is equal to 1/3. If we recognize this as geometric, but could not identify the pattern for r, remember we can take any term in the series and divide by the term before it. So if we used 8/9, we could divide this by 8/3 to determine r. This would be the same as 8/9 times the reciprocal, which is 3/8. The 8s simplify out, 3s simplify nicely, and of course we have r equal to 1/3. Again, since the absolute value of r is less than 1, this will have an infinite sum. It's going to be equal to the first term, which is 8, divided by 1 minus r, 1 minus 1/3. So we have 8 divided by 2/3, which is the same as 8 times the reciprocal. So this infinite sum will be 12. Therefore, this geometric series converges. Okay, this is just the first of many tests we'll take a look at in order to determine whether an infinite series converges or diverges. I hope you found this helpful.